On Wednesday, the Lord began to deal with me about a subject matter that I was trying to recollect if I've ever really spoken specifically on this, and the Lord really dealt with me about it. And then when I was teaching it on Wednesday, I felt like that I need to minister this to us as a congregation. We know that Wednesday is your off day, so we want to minister it on a day that you can, and still receive this. I want you to turn with me to the book of Philippians. I want you to turn with me to the book of Philippians, the second chapter of the book of Philippians. Turn with me, Philippians 2, and I'm going to start at the first verse and read. When you have it, say amen. It says, "If there be therefore any consolation in Christ, if any comfort of love, if any fellowship of the Spirit, if any bowels of and mercies, fulfill ye my joy, that ye be like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord and of one mind. Let nothing be done through strife or vain glory, but in lowliness of mind let each esteem others better than themselves. Look not every man on his own things, but every man also on the things of others. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, took upon him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men. And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Wherefore God also hath highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of things in heaven, of things in earth, and of things under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father." I also want to add verse number 14. "Do all things without murmuring or disputing." I want to also look at a few other openings. I want you to turn to James, the fourth chapter. James, the fourth chapter. And I want you to look at the 10th verse. The 10th verse says, "Humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord, and he shall lift thee up." Look at 1 Peter 5, and it's reiteration of what we just read in James. 1 Peter 5 and verse 6. "Humble yourselves therefore under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time." I'm gonna start a series of messages. And the series is going to be called "The Power of Humility." The power of humility. The power of humility. We don't hear a lot of messages about humility, but I want to focus on this because I believe it's very important for us to to understand that humility is a powerful attribute for us to have, and it has power. Most people equate humility and meekness with weakness, but the Bible says that the meek shall inherit the earth. In other words, they get the whole deal. So this particular first message that I want to minister in this series called The Power of Humility is, this first message will be called Humble Yourself. Humble Yourself. Philippians 2 gives us Christ's example of humility. He said, let this mind, verse 5 says, be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, took upon himself the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men, and being found fashioned as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Wherefore God hath highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee shall bow of things in heaven, things in earth, things under the earth, and every tongue shall confess that Jesus is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. I want to talk about, because I believe that first thing that we must understand is, and the reason that I'm focusing on this subject, is to humble yourself. Humility is not automatic, and it is not something that God does. It's something that you do for yourself. You have to humble yourself. God's not going to do it for you. God doesn't humble, God humiliates. If you don't humble yourself, God will humiliate you in order to humble you. When the Bible says that when the children of Israel came out of the land of Egypt and they dwelt in the wilderness, and the Bible says for 40 years they dwelt in the wilderness, that God tested them and proved them and humbled them in the wilderness to see what was in their heart. And so instead of them being a journey of a few days into the promised land, they actually ended up being 40 years in the wilderness, and God tested them, God humiliated them, humbled them. I don't know about you, but I don't want to be humiliated by God. Humility is the antidote to the poison of pride. Humility is the antidote for the poison of pride. Pride goes before destruction, a haughty spirit before fall. I want to read a few scriptures that focuses on pride. And I want you to understand that God hates the proud. He resists the proud. He can't stand proud folk. The Bible says these six things does God hate. A proud look. And one of the things that the Lord began to deal with me about is that that humility, if we are going to function together in this covenant community and work together, one of the things that we're going to need more than anything else is we're going to need humility, and we're going to need to humble ourselves. We're going to need to humble ourselves in order to be able to effectively serve in the kingdom of God and to serve God. And so I want you to look at a few. Turn with me to Proverbs, the 16th chapter, the Old Testament. Proverbs. Well, let's look at the 8th chapter first, then we'll go to 16. Proverbs 8 and 13. Because one of the things that God hates more than anything is arrogance and pride. And there is a sentence on pride. And so, you know, when you are infused with pride, it's like you got a disease. It's like, and there's only one antidote to pride, and that's humility. Proverbs 8 and 13 says, the reverent fear, excuse me, I was reading it amplified. Let's read it in the King James. The fear of the Lord is to hate evil, pride, and arrogance, and the evil way, and the froward mouth do I hate. Now, I don't know about you, but I don't want to be on the bad side of God. Pride will put you on the bad side. Why? Because Satan fell as a result of pride. The Bible says Lucifer was beautiful in his adornment until pride was found in him. And the disease that the church is fighting, the church is trying to get healed of, is the disease of pride. Everybody want to be somebody. Everybody want to sit at the head table. Everybody wants a title. Everybody wants the pulpit. Everybody wants to be acknowledged. Pride. And it says the Lord, the fear of the Lord is to hate evil, pride, arrogance, the evil way, the froward mouth do I hate. In the Amplified it says, the reverent fear and worshipful awe of the Lord includes the hatred of evil, pride, arrogance, evil way, perverted and twisted speech do I hate. In other words, I can't stand pride. God won't even allow you to with your pride to stand in his presence. Pride is a disease. It's infused in the church now until we can't even function together because, praise God, because of our own pride. Pride keeps us divided. Pride keeps us, praise God, envying one another and competing with one another. And God hates it. And he does, and he is not going to allow us to function with pride, because no man will ever glory in his presence. If God don't get the glory, let me tell you something, God hates it. Humility is the only remedy. It's the only antidote. Look at Proverbs 16. God hates arrogance. Boy, I'm telling you, just head up in the sky, can't be told anything. You know, in other words, praise God, you know, an inflated estimation of who you are. Not realizing that everything you got from God. The breath you breathing is God's. And you are who you are because of God. Thank you, Jesus. Chapter 16, Proverbs 16. And let's look at verse 18. And it reads, pride goeth before destruction, and a haughty spirit before a fall. The reason that many times we keep falling in the same thing that we over and over again, or falling for the same thing that we, is that pride always brings a fall. Pride always brings you down. God always, praise God, makes the proud abase. He always brings them low. Pride goes before destruction. If you stay in pride, your dreams will be destroyed, your life will be destroyed. When Satan rose up in pride, the Bible says, praise God, that God cast him out of heaven. And praise God. And so, in other words, praise God, his place of being the anointed cherub that covereth, the Bible calls him. Now, praise God, he has been brought low, and now his name is Satan, Lucifer. Satan, the adversary. Pride will always bring you down. Now, I'm going to give you some powerful things that humility will bring in your life, but I want you to see what pride will do for you first. Pride goes before destruction. A haughty spirit before a fall. Go over to the 29th chapter of Proverbs. See, pride is what keeps us from being able to work together in the church. It's pride. Stay with me. I know it's tight, but it's right. Chapter 29 of Proverbs. And let's look at verse 23. A man's pride shall bring him low, but honor shall uphold the humble in spirit. In other words, your pride will always bring you down. Your arrogance will always bring you down. Your boasting will always bring you down. You ain't that all that in a bag of chips. God is the one that made you who you are. And you better give him the glory. You better know that your pride will cause you to come to poverty. Pride is a dangerous thing. It's because it causes you to that God never will cooperate, never will move for you, never. Because why? Because he resists the proud. He doesn't even want to be around you. And you know what? I don't either. Arrogance, I can't stand arrogant people. Now that's just, you know, you say, I love them, but I just can't be around them. You know, they're a legend in their own mind. Not in their time, in their mind. But the Bible tells us that let this mind be in you that was also in Christ Jesus. I am sick of people trying to be like Mike instead of trying to be like Christ. We have picked out individuals in the world that we think we want to be like. Everybody wants to be like somebody. You know, and what we have to understand is it's nothing wrong with seeing people that are successful and praise God and desiring to be successful but the thing is that we are not to be mentored to people. We're to be mentored to Christ. Paul said, follow me as I follow. In other words, we are looking for mentors. This person is mentoring me. For what? To be like them? The Bible says we were predestinated before the foundation of the earth to be conformed to the image of Christ. I don't know about you, but I'm trying to be like Christ. I'm trying to have my life molded in the image and the reflection of Christ. I want to be able to reflect Christ. And Christ, the Son of the living God, God manifests in the flesh. His attitude was, I know I'm God, but I will humble myself. Folk that always got to push themselves up will always pull somebody else down is because they really don't know who they are. Anytime you got to go around spouting your title all the time, you bishop this and you apostle this and you prophetess this and you doctor this and you know, praise God. Well, that's all good. But Paul said like this, Paul said, I am what I am by the grace of God. Paul said, I'm an apostle, but I'm also an elder, and I'm also a servant. Do you know the greatest in the kingdom of God is not
the one that praise God, that has the greatest title, but it's the one that serves, praise God, effectively among his peers, among those that he fellowships with. Service, Jesus said, was the greatest thing in the kingdom of God, was to serve. Some of us, praise God, we need the antidote. Pride has kept us. I think about, and this is something we need to understand, is that it takes humility to be able to function in a community. It takes humility. Let's read through Philippians, and I'm going to highlight some of the things, and then I'm going to give you the first five powerful things that humility brings. I'm going to give you those things, but I want to go back to, because I the Lord began to deal with me about one of the things that if we're going to be effectively working together for the kingdom of God in this community, in any church community, one of the things that we need to really ask God is to cause us to humble ourselves. We need to lay down our titles. We need to lay down our credentials. We need to and we need to know, praise God, that I am a servant of God first. That's why I believe with all my heart that God puts us in the household of faith and puts us in churches, is because, you know why he puts us in churches? Because sometimes, praise God, maybe on our job we're the boss. We're the chief executive. We might have a big job. We might have a big title on our job. But we need to come to the church community and realize, praise God, that when you get in this community, that the greatest in this community is someone that serves, and you need to serve doing some kind of service in the house of the Lord. I like what Prophet Kevin Leal talks about. He ministers all over the world, minister, and praise God. But he has a church home, and when he gets back to his church home, he serves in the church. Amen. It's amazing to me. I know this is not the happy sermon, but this is a sermon that will make you have a Selah moment and think we need to humble ourselves. Because the thing about it is why you can't usher. Why you can't sing? Why you can't serve? Why you can't be a deacon? Why you can't serve nowhere? Because why? Because you so anointed? You are no more anointed than Jesus. Jesus was more anointed than you. Jesus had a greater title than you. He thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but he humbled himself. Look at your neighbor and say, humble yourself. If Jesus humbled himself, you ought to be able to humble yourself. You ought to be able to humble yourself and serve. You ought to be able to humble yourself and serve God's people and serve the community, praise God, of believers. Paul, in this particular scripture, the preface of talking about Christ's humility is really prefaced by verse 1 and verse 2 of Philippians. And so I'm going to read in the Amplified translation so you really can see the amplification of what Paul is trying to get the Philippian believers, because these were believers in Christ. He wrote to this was Paul and Timothy writing to the saints that were at Philippi, the bishops and the deacons. If you read that first verse in chapter 1, it talks about it was to the saints, and then it was to the bishops and the deacons. I love that, because he didn't leave nobody out. So if you're a bishop or a deacon, if you're a prophet or apostle, you're an evangelist or you're a teacher, he's writing to you. And this is what he says in the Amplified translation. It says chapter 2 verse 1 says, so by whatever appeal to you that there is in our mutual dwelling in Christ, by whatever strengthening and consoling and encouraging our relationship in him affords, by whatever persuasive incentive there is in love, by whatever participation in the Holy Spirit we share, and by whatever depth of affection and compassion and sympathy. Verse 2 says, fill up and complete my joy by living in harmony and being of the same mind and one in purpose, having the same love, being in full accord and of one harmonious intention, doing nothing, verse 3 says, from the factional motives, through contentious strife, selfishness, or for unworthy ends, or prompted by conceit and empty arrogance. Instead, in the true spirit of humility, lowliness of mind, let each regard others as better and superior to himself, thinking more highly of one another than you do of yourselves. As long as you think you are all of that and a bag of chips, you're going to want people serving you instead of you serving. And Paul is trying to tell them, I want y'all to work in harmony together, but you cannot work in harmony together unless first you humble yourself. Because it's going to take humility. We know that you got 3 degrees. You know, we know you got more degrees than a thermometer. We know, praise God, that you took voice lessons from Juilliard. We know, praise God, that on your job you the supervisor. But Jesus was God manifest in the flesh. Jesus was equal with God. And you know what? I believe that the reason that God reveals himself to the church in the Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, is to show the divine cooperation and humility among the Godhead. Because even though Jesus was God, he didn't go around talking about, I'm God. I'm God. He could have said, when they were trying to figure out how to redeem us, he could have said, look, I'm God too, Holy Spirit. You go down and die for them. Hey. Father God, you go down. But he humbled himself. Have you ever done something, humbled yourself in a way, praise God, that did not focus on you, but focused on something bigger than you, a purpose bigger than you, and served? See, that's what humility does. Jesus, for a greater purpose, made himself of no reputation, took on himself the form of a servant, and was made in likeness as a man. I'm telling you, he was God. But he was wrapped up in the likeness of sinful flesh. And he became a servant. Where do you serve? Where do you really serve? I'm talking about serve. So quiet in this place. Yeah, this is the blessed quietness. It says in verse 3, let nothing be done through strife or vain glory, but in lowliness of mind, let esteem others better than himself. In the Amplified, it says, be empty arrogance, be done with conceit. In other words, so I want us to understand that unless you humble yourself, you are not humble. Now, God can humiliate you, and you submit under his judgment for your pride. But what you need to do is you need to lower yourself. You need to understand that you're not to think more highly of yourself than you ought to think. You ought to think soberly. You ought to realize, praise God, that everything that you are is because of his grace and his mercy. Some of the definitions of humility is not proud, not arrogant, modest, humble, although successful. In other words, humble, although successful. I know you're a supervisor, but can you be humble even when you're successful? Sometimes the reason God can't bless some folk is because if they got it, they got so much pride until, praise God, they'd be going around acting like they did it themselves. Act like they got there all by themselves. Let me tell you something. Nobody is where they are, not on the on the shoulders of somebody else. It just came to me. It's interesting. This week they were talking about our president, and you know, his story that he would usually tell is that he was given $1 million by his father that he had to pay back, and so he pulled himself up by his bootstraps. Of course, they went back and found out, praise God, that his father actually gave him over $60 million, which is equal to about $400 million today. Let me tell you something. You give me $60 million, I'd be successful too. But he makes out like, see, because pride causes you to exaggerate and inflate who you are and what you've done. But humility, his humility, what he should have been saying is, I'm thankful that my father helped me. See, pride will do that to you. Let nothing be done through vainglory, but in lowliness of mind, esteeming others better than himself. Do you know humility will cause you to appreciate and respect other people? It will cause you to appreciate the grace and the gifts on other folk besides yourself.
I was sharing with them on Wednesday. One of the things that I don't try to do is I don't try to make Sister Hogan in my own image and likeness. I let her be. I respect her. And I talk to them about respect. It's because if you don't respect what's on the lives of others, you can never work together. You can have two people that don't even agree with one another, but if they respect one another, they can work together. And respecting one of the definitions that is humility is courteously respectful. In other words, praise God, that you can appreciate somebody else. Sometimes what we have to understand is that we're not competing with one another. One of the things that gets me a lot of times is that I'll minister a message. Don't get me wrong, I'm not trying to, but I'll minister a message. And people, you know, I'm given the responsibility to share what I believe God has given me for the people of God. And then I'll come out of the pulpit or whatever, and someone will instead of them saying to me, Pastor, I receive. What they'll begin to do many times is say, you know what? God gave me that same message. But mine was like this. I don't need to hear your sermon. God gave the sermon for you to listen to, not for you to, praise God, to now compare sermons. Oh Lord. Have you ever talked to somebody about something of good fortune that you had and you say, oh, you know what? And then they try to tell you how much better. That's pride. Can't you just appreciate that somebody else got a new car? Can't you just appreciate the new dress that somebody else got or the new suit that somebody else got? Why is it that you got to start talking about your suit? Oh, Lord. I know that. It's pride. I can do anything. You can do better. I can do anything better than you. That's pride.
Can't you encourage? Can't you stand and encourage somebody for what God has done for them? Can't you enjoin yourself to what the Lord has blessed them with and celebrate with them the blessing that they got? So we can't. So how do we work together? Well, you know, if God is leading me this way, then you got to tell me what God is leading you the other way. And so since God is leading, and instead of you humbling yourself, now we got a conflict because you didn't heard from God and I didn't heard from God.
Okay, let me get the humility. So we need the antidote. Some of y'all, I'm not going to say, I know none of y'all in here, but some of them folks that y'all know, it's amazing to me. We have people come to Living Bread Church, and thank God. And because I think we are prophetic and apostolic church, we get a lot of gifted people. A lot of gifted people come to our church. I realize that. But what we have to be really very careful of is that when we come, we should come because we're coming to serve and not to be served. We're not coming for an advantage. I remember we had they're no longer members of this church. You don't know who they are, so don't. But I remember we had an individual come. And they wanted the chief seat. Get mad. We would have service. They'd get mad if you didn't sit them on the front. Mad. I mean, mad with the ushers. Ushers come and say, "Well, you know, that was." So-and-so, see, no, they got to come up and sit. To be very careful. Because they felt like because they had been something somewhere else, they were the same over here. But see, if you didn't serve over there, when you come over here, the first prerequisite is, do you serve? If you don't serve, then I know you're not humble. I know you're not fit to be elevated because humility always precedes elevation and promotion. I know it's tight, but it's right. I had one person come. They never mentioned, they were the associate pastor of a church. Never told me, never said anything to me, just served. And the Lord began to deal with me, and the Lord said, now, I want to elevate them. I want you to do and begin to deal with me about them. Because their attitude was correct, God says that he resists the proud. He gives grace to the humble. If you humble yourself, you'll be exalted. If you exalt yourself, you'll be abased. And so, praise God, because they were serving, God could elevate them. Ooh, Lord have mercy. This must be a good sermon. It's quiet in here. Let this mind be in you. What is your attitude? Do you look at others? Do you look at others with the level that I'm just as good as anybody else? Well, don't get me wrong. We all equal, but we don't all function in the same at the same level. But we all called to serve. Amen. And so we cannot get to the point where because we think we're all that we can't serve, we can't humble ourselves and serve in a capacity that we think, many times we think it's beneath us. You know, Apostle, Lord is calling me and moving me to a higher anointing. I can no longer usher.
I can no longer sing because, see, now God has moved me. That's why we need homes. I was raised in a home. I don't care how anointed I was, I served. And when I come home, Sister Hogan, I serve. She, you know, I run things like the vacuum cleaner. Everybody's serving in the house. Take out the trash. This morning she was like, "That trash. I got the trash." And pick up the trash. Do some service. The greatest among you is service. Jesus took on himself the form of a servant. Why can't you serve? You waiting for the right spot that fits who you think you are? Let me give you some things, and I'm going, because you know I'm gonna have to get y'all's toes healed. I'm stepping all over your toes. He was in the form of God. He was equal with God, but he didn't try to have a reputation. You don't know who I am. At my other church, I was prophet so-and-so. That was your problem. You should have been known by your service more than known by your title. Everybody wants a title now, you know. He made himself a nobody. He took on himself the form of a servant in the likeness of man. See, humility breaks the power of selfishness, self-focused. Think of more highly of others than you think of yourself. In other words, it's not telling you to put yourself down. What it's telling you is to respect other people and their function and who they are also. I know many times in my own family, I don't even like to, when I go around my family, I don't like to even talk about anything that the Lord may have blessed me with or anything like that, because sometimes it's just so much competition. Have you, and I know none of y'all don't have, but I got 15 in my family, you know, 10 boys, 5 girls, and sometimes it can be just, so if they start talking about, I just enjoy what God has blessed them with, because I don't want to mention. Because I don't want to get into it. The Bible says that it is foolish to compare yourselves among yourselves. It is not wise. The reason you keep comparing yourself with other folk and looking up to other folk is because, praise God, you don't understand, praise God, that is not your measurement. Your measurement is Christ. And if you measure yourself with Christ, you'll lower yourself real quick. If you look at Christ and put yourself up next to him, you will humble yourself. You will look at the power and the authority and the glory that was in him, praise God, and put yourself. You say, oh, no, no, no. But as long as you're comparing yourself with your brother, your sister, praise God, and you always pick out somebody you think you better than. Always picking out somebody you think you better than. You know what? We're all because of the grace of God who we are. God wants to deliver us from this spirit of selfishness. It's all about us. Everything's about us. And God wants us to be selfless. Well, it's not all about me. Well, what am I going to get out of it? If I serve, what am I going to get out of it? Why don't you let God pay you instead of trying to get man to pay you? If you want the blessings of man, you're never going to get paid well. God will pay you what is rightfully yours. See, humility always comes before promotion. You can't be promoted until you humble yourself. Let me close. Let me go to another. I'm gonna go to a whole. Let's go to Mark, the 10th chapter, and I wanna just go over some, give you this story, because this is kind of, I got a lot that I want to share in this series, and so that we can adjust ourselves, because humility is the ingredient that we need more than anything else, because humility brings the presence of God. Humility brings the power of God. Humility causes your prayers to be answered. Humility causes God to inhabit with you. There is so much power in humility that I'm going to share with you, and then praise God. And I hope that you'll begin to desire to walk in humility. Let's look at Mark 10. I got 5 more minutes. This is Mark 10. I'm gonna read from the. From the 42nd verse of Mark 10. Mark 10, 42. When you have it, say amen. It says, but Jesus called them to him and saith unto them, ye know that they which are counted to rule over the Gentiles exercise lordship over them, and their great ones exercise authority upon them. But so shall it not be among you. But whosoever will be great among you shall be your minister. And whosoever of you will be the chiefest shall be servant of all. And then he says something that's so powerful. For even the Son of Man came not to be ministered to, but to minister, and to give his life a ransom for many. That's his example again. Now I want to give you the picture, because you don't understand this, what Jesus is saying, unless you understand it in the context. This was the story. When you read, I'm going to paraphrase, but if you read, go back up and read this whole story. This was when Jesus was coming with his disciples, and James and John came to Jesus and said to him, Jesus, said, we got a request. In fact, their mama got involved in it. Say, I got a request. And she requested for Jesus. And then they came and said, and he said, what is your request? They said, when you come into your kingdom, let me sit on one side of your right hand, and then you sit on the, and then he'll sit on the left hand. We want to sit on either side of you, right next to you. See, pride always wants proximity. Pride always wants to be close proximity to what they think is the leader, is the chief. They want to be close. And if they can't get close, they're upset. And he's talking about, we want to be on each side. Jesus said, y'all don't even know what y'all asking for. You know what? This sounds like the church. I want to be the bishop. I want to be the apostle. I want to be the chief. I want to be the Archbishop Deluxe. I want to be this, and I want to be that, and I want to be, you know, close to you, and so on and so forth. Well, you know, the thing is, Jesus said, that ain't the way it operates in the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God don't operate by, praise God, by you trying to get, and some people think as if they can get close to somebody that they admire, that what's on them gonna fall on them. I admire Jesus. I'm trying to be like him. I appreciate these others that have gifts and graces on their life and so on and so forth. But look, you know what? I am not going to run around trying to carry somebody's bag to get their anointing. Now, don't get me wrong. That's nothing wrong with serving. I was telling them on Wednesday, I served my apostle. When we were in Africa, we were in Ethiopia, you know, he didn't ask me to serve him. I served him because you know why? It's because you need to keep your service muscles strong. Because if you don't, they'll atrophy and then, praise God, and get stiff. And you'll lose your ability to serve. I don't want to ever get to the point where I just want everybody bowing down to me as if I'm Jesus. So my service is because I need to serve. And leaders really need to keep their service muscles good. Because the tendency is to want everybody, you know, you got 40 entourage with you. You know, I hear this, I'm walking, I got an entourage of all, you know, folks just walking behind me, carrying my bags, you know, tying up my shoe, putting on my hat. Now, don't get me wrong, there's nothing wrong with that serving, and I know that some have taken to the extreme that, you know, you get the anointing by doing, and, you know, and if you give the preacher enough money, and if you give him a Cadillac, then you'll get a Cadillac. You know, I'm not, you know, I don't want to take nothing to the extreme. There's something called honor, and you should honor. But the thing about it is that my goal is not to fashion. My goal is to point you to Christ. My goal is to get you focused on Christ. If you get more like Christ, then I'm satisfied with you. Because I know if you're like Christ, you're going to serve. Well, when everybody in the church in the pew got an armor bearer. People get mad at you. Know, people want to get go to speak, got 6 armor bearers out of my church. You done took 6 armor bearers with you out of our church to carry your bag. You can't serve in your church, but somebody call you up and you think they got an anointing and you running around behind them. That's something wrong with that. I'm going to point you to Jesus. Let this mind be in you that was also in Christ. I'm not trying to I love Apostle John. I love Apostle Eckhart. But I'm not trying to get Apostle Eckhart's anointing. I need my own anointing. That's what's wrong with y'all now. Trying to put on Saul's armor, and God never designed that armor for you. God called you, praise God, to pick up a few stones, praise God, and a slingshot. And you carrying a sword that's too big for you, trying to carry a prophetic sword that you can't even carry. Oh, Lord. Humble yourself. Humble yourself under the mighty hand of God. Let God exalt you. God will anoint you. God will put his grace upon you. God will bless you, praise God, if you will humble yourself under the mighty hand of God. Not under the mighty hand of your Elijah. Don't get me wrong. There is a principle there, but sometimes we take it all to the extreme. Let me tell you something. You better humble yourself under the mighty hand of God, and God will exalt you. We want to sit on the right and we want to sit on the left. Jesus said, that ain't the way it works. That ain't the way it works in the kingdom. God will find you when you're serving. I was sharing with them when I was a Sunday school teacher. I was a Sunday school teacher at my dad's church. Sunday school teacher, had a little Sunday school class, and so on. You got to learn how to build where you are. If you get put over something, you should build it. You don't get over something and then let it die. You build it. When folk would come in to serve, come to the church, and they had children that was the age of the children that was in my Sunday school class, I was over there talking to the mama and the daddy and saying to them, praise the Lord, God bless you. I see you got these 2 children, and I'm the Sunday school teacher of this class. Why don't you have your children come, and I'll pick them up if I have to, and praise God. And my class just kept on growing, kept on being blessed. Next thing you know, my father had me. He seen where God was blessing me there, and praise God, and seen I had a grace for teaching, and then he put me over the Wednesday Bible study. Why? Because I was serving. And then he put me over to Wednesday Bible study. I was a deacon. I wasn't even called to preach. He had me teaching. Then God called me to preach. Praise God. And then praise God that he seen the grace on my life for teaching and laying on of hands, and I laid hands on the sick. I was the one that ministered. My father would pray some, but he would usually pray a general prayer, but many times he would say, son, you come, and I would pray because I had went to the hospital and prayed for one of the members that had cancer, and God healed her, and praise God. And my father said, there's something on your life. But look at somebody say, but he was serving. If you're serving, God knows where to find you. If you won't serve where you are, you won't serve when you get up there.
Oh, Lord. We want to sit on the right and we want to sit on the left. Jesus said, you don't know what you're asking for. Because if you want to ask for that, you're going to have to go through what I went through. I like that. Folk always want your title, but they don't know what you've been through to get there. They don't know all the hell and all of the devils you had to fight. And then they think they can do what you do. And then as soon as they get out and the devil beats them from pillar to post and send them back, praise God, with their tail between their legs, and they wondering what's wrong, is they're fighting devils that they were never elevated and never set in a position to confront. Because every level brings a new devil.
Thank you, Jesus. Jesus said, this ain't the way it works in the kingdom. It don't work that way in the kingdom. Let me tell you, it don't work. You can try to pride yourself, get up next to the right people, meet the right people, get in the presence of someone, carry somebody's bag, running around trying to be mentored by somebody. Praise God. Let me tell you something. It don't work that way. God is looking for somebody to serve. And as I've said, I've served in every area of the church. I've served as a janitor. I've served as an usher. I've served as a deacon. I've served in every capacity. But one thing, praise God, is that I served with all of my strength and my heart. This half-hearted service. Okay, I'm closing. Jesus called him and said unto him, ye know that which are accounted to be rulers over the Gentiles exercise lordship over them, and their great ones exercise authority over them. But so shall it not be among you. For whosoever shall be great among you shall be your minister, and whoever will be the chiefest shall be your servant of all. I understand that I'm a servant. I serve the people of God. I serve you. I know you, but you know people think this is a glamour. They think these are glamour positions. They don't know sometimes you crying all night long. Sometimes you got to be before God, praise God, and praise God while other folks are sleeping, you praying. They don't understand, praise God, that it's more because this morning I was saying to the Lord, I said, Lord, these are your people. These are your people. What do you want me to share with them? I want to speak your word. And the Lord began to just rabble off. He said, humility is the antidote to pride. I begin to put it in my phone. He said, humility breaks the power of selfishness. He said, humility comes before promotion. He said, humility releases exhortation. He said, humility releases God's ability. Do you know the Bible says God gives grace to the humble? And he began to just rabble off. I just began to put them down. It was 10 different points that the Lord gave me. I'll talk about them in this message. But what I want you to see is that it doesn't work that way in the kingdom. You have to serve. And the only way we can serve is serve through humility. One of the things that James 4 talks about is that there's wars and there's strife among us, and we're warring with one another, and we're wondering why we're warring with one another. And then James comes down to verse 10 and talks about humility. And he talks about the fact that if you don't have humility, you can't work together. Do you know that if we're going to get the work of God done, we're going to have to humble ourselves? I love people to just come in and work. Jesus said, send laborers into the kingdom. He didn't say send skilled laborers. He said, send laborers. Lord, pray to give me some laborers. Just give me some folks that will work on the line. Because folks are so specialized now. They specialize now. They can't sing because they specialize. I'm specialized. I'm a press specialist. I'm a prophetic specialist. I'm a deliverance specialist. Can I just get some laborers? Can I get some folks that just will do the work? Thank you, Jesus. Jesus said that the greatest is the one that is the minister. Let me just give you one more point. And this is to me is one of the most powerful things. I shared it Wednesday. I just want to share it. And this is what the Lord gave me. God says humility releases God's ability. Say that with me. Humility releases God's ability. And this is what the Lord showed me. He said he resists the proud, he gives grace to the humble. Most of us, when we think of grace, we think of God's unmerited favor. That is grace. But grace is also God's divine ability given. In other words, grace is God's ability to do things that you could not do in your own self. When you humble yourself, what God does is God gives you his ability, where you don't have to operate in your own ability. You will find, praise God, as I said on Wednesday, grace is it gives you the ability to do things smooth. It's like oil in your engine. If you put oil in, change your oil right, the engine runs smooth. You don't have no oil in it, you throw a rod, clink de clink de clink. And that is the way, and so the ability of God. See, many times you're trying to do things in your flesh that you cannot accomplish because you're trying to do it in your own strength. But when you humble yourself, God gives you grace and the ability. The grace of God that bringeth salvation, the Bible says, has appeared unto all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present earth. In other words, the grace of God can give you the ability to live righteously, holy, and godly. But it's not of yourself. It's of the grace of God. And when the grace of God comes on your life for a certain activity, for a certain responsibility, or for a certain assignment, God will cause you to be able to do it even though you don't have the expertise to do it. I love the way God gives me ability beyond my education. You know, I don't have no, you know, earned degrees. I was 2 years in 2 year in college and got married. And that was that. All the ability I have is because of the grace of God. Paul said, I am what I am by the grace of God. And God will give you a grace to do some things, and you'll just be marveled at some of the things that you're able to do just because he gave you his grace. But if you don't humble yourself and you get into pride, he'll resist you. He'll resist what you're trying to do. And it looks like you're always bumping your head against the same wall. But grace is God's ability to do what you couldn't do in your own strength. Be careful and not try to do everything in your flesh. The Lord spoke something to me. He said, Satan is as a roaring lion. He is a flesh eater. God told me he's a flesh eater. The more of your flesh that shows, the more he can eat you up. Humility is when you humble yourself, you're bringing down or you're crucifying your flesh, and you're operating in the spirit. So don't try to do in your flesh what God will allow you to have grace to do. God will give you grace to make money. You know, God can give you a grace to make money. I remember probably about the same age I am, but he was younger then. I was younger then too. He's a very, 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 very wealthy man, and he didn't have a fifth grade education. but a very, very wealthy man. But you know what? He was a deacon there. He was the biggest giver in the church. I mean, it was nothing for him to give a $10,000 offering. It's nothing for him to give a $10,000 offering. You know, $10,000, $20,000. You know, it just. But he was wealthy. And his testimony was God showed him how to make money. He ain't got no accounting degree. I mean, he can count his money. But God gave him the grace. He gives grace to the humble. God's ability will be released in your life if you humble yourself. God will give you ability beyond the some things that I've done in life. I said, I ain't nowhere in the world I could do that but with God. Ain't nowhere in the world I'd be where I am without God. Ain't nowhere in the world I would be as successful as I am without God. It's all attributed to God. Stand on your feet. God's ability to do what you could not do in your own self, in your own strength. It's time for us to humble ourselves. Humble ourselves enough that we can serve. Bow your heads. Father, we thank you and praise you. Lord, you said humility releases your ability. People have been trying to do stuff in their own flesh and wondering why it won't work. They've been trying to attract you into their lives, but you said you're among those that have a broken and contrite spirit. A humble spirit causes your presence to come. Lord, we humble ourselves. Now, let me say this as I'm speaking to you, is that this is something you will have to do yourself. It's a decision that you will make. It's a decision that you'll make of whether or not you're going to submit yourself to God. Humble yourself before God. Humble yourself before one another. Think more, think not selfishly, but think selflessly. It's your decision. Father, we thank you and we praise you, Lord God, for the word today. We thank you, O God, for the word concerning humility. Father, you said you resist the proud, but you give grace to the humble. Father, we humble ourselves. Lord, we lower ourselves in spiritual sackcloth and ashes. Humble ourselves. You said humble yourself with fasting. Fasting kills the flesh so that Satan won't eat us up. Break the spirit of pride, the Lucifer spirit of pride that had bound the church, trying to do the things the same way the world does them. Trying to succeed the same way the world succeeds. But Lord, success is in our humility and our submission to you. Lord, and we rededicate ourselves to humility and selflessness. We bind every spirit of arrogance and pride, this conceit. Father, deliver us, Lord God. Father, make us servants. Lord, we enlist in your service. Whatever our hands find to do, Lord, we want to do it. And we don't want to do it as unto man, but we're going to do it as unto you, Lord. We're serving you. We're not serving man. We're serving you. Lord, you said the greatest among us would be a servant of all. You said unless we became like little children and humbled ourselves and became as a little child, you said that's the greatness in the kingdom. Father, break the spirit of pride. Break the spirit of competition. and competing with one another. Why didn't I get it? Why didn't he put me there? Father, help us to understand that it's you that elevate. It's you that raises up and puts down. And Father, you will not forget our labor of love. If we're laboring in love and service, you'll find us right where we are. Father, help us to be a community of believers that serve one another, love one another, and serve one another, so that, Lord God, that you might be glorified. Let this mind that was in Christ be in us, Lord God. We thank you and we praise you for it. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Put your hands together and give God praise.